Okay. Thank you very much. So, since this is a seminar on basic notions, I decided to start from the very beginning, and I try to explain in 1 hour what is calculus of variations, and so what are the tools that we use. So, calculus of variations is essentially minimizing functionals, which means functions which depend on functions. And so a typical example could be consider a function of this form, integral over an interval of some function of f u of x u prime x in dx. And in this example, u will be some function from the interval ab with real values, and f is a function of 3 variables, x, second variable that is replaced by u of x, I will call it y, and the third variable, x. So these are variables in R. And the problem in this case will be to find a minimum of this functional, assuming that u is a function defined here, that it satisfies some boundary conditions. So just to give an example, say that u of a is equal to some prescribed value alpha, u of b some prescribed value beta. So the problem is find the function u, which makes this function as small as possible. Of course, this is just an example. Other interesting examples come when you consider a problem in an open set over Rn instead of an interval. These are also very interesting. So in this case, the function we want to consider will be of this form. Now the difference is that omega is usually an open set in Rn. U will be a function defined in this set with the real values. And this is the gradient of the function u. And so in this case, the function f is defined just for x in omega. And this y will be a real number. But this will be a vector, because then we have here the gradient. So, just to understand the interest of these problems, what are some interesting examples of functions functions like this? For instance, for this, I can give as an example the example of the surfaces on rotation. So let me describe the problem in this way. We have the plane xy, and suppose that we have some curve y equal u of x on this plane, and assume that this u is strictly positive. Then what we want to do is to rotate this curve around the x-axis. And so what we get will be some surface of rotation. Now, what is the area of this surface of rotation? It can be expressed in terms of the function u quite easily, because there is a standard formula, there is a factor 2 pi, and then the integral between a and b, if a and b are these 2 points where the function is defined. And then we have here u of x square root 1 plus u prime x square in dx. So you see, this is a particular case of a function like this, which has a geometric meaning. And now, a problem like this, minimizing the function with this condition, means the following: that at A, I fixed this equal to alpha, and this means that the radius of this circle will be prescribed, it is alpha. Here at B, I have a radius beta, And so geometrically, the problem is the following. We have two circles in the space. They have the same symmetry axis. And now I'm considering all surfaces of rotation that connect this circle to the other circle. And I want to find the one with minimal area. And so I'm led to a problem that can be written precisely in this form. So interesting examples of problems like this, and also classical examples, are the so-called Dirichlet integral, which is integral over omega gradient u of x squared. So this is very important, and we will see why later, because this is related to harmonic functions. The minimization of this integral is also connected with the problem of finding a harmonic function with prescribed boundary conditions. Another functional that is interesting and classical in the case of Rn is the functional the area of the graph of some function. So here u will be a function defined in omega with values in R. You can ask what is the area of the graph of the function u. And this is given by the well-known formula square root 1 plus gradient u x square dx. And so also this one is a function that can be written in this form. When we minimize, I forgot to say that when we minimize these functions which are defined in a domain of Rn, usually we prescribe some boundary condition on the boundary of omega. So, for instance, in the case of the area, we have that we have some domain omega. And then on the boundary of omega, we have some prescribed function. This, its graph will represent a curve in the space. And then we are considering the surfaces that have this boundary and that can be represented as graphs. And for these surfaces, we have this formula. And so this means that when we try to minimize this, we want to find the surface of minimal area that can be written as a graph and with prescribed boundary conditions. Well, so this is just an introduction. Now, what are the tools that are used to solve these minimum problems? So historically, the first tool that was developed was something that gives you some necessary condition for minimality. So essentially, you say, suppose that u is a minimizer, then it must satisfy some precise conditions. And this is done by a method, which is the method of variations, which gives the name to the field. So the idea is this. Now I will consider just the simplest case, the case where the function is defined over an interval. And so suppose that u is a minimizer. And then the idea is I consider a variation of u. Variation means what? That I add to u some other small function. So for this reason, I put an epsilon in front of it. Then epsilon will go to zero. And this phi will be just a function defined on the same interval with the properties that it vanishes on the boundary. And so now the idea is u is a minimizer. This function, the variation of u, satisfies the same boundary conditions because phi is zero at the boundary. And so because of the minimality, we must have that this inequality is satisfied. And now the idea is that this is satisfied for every epsilon, not just for a single epsilon. And so one can define a function of the real variable epsilon in this way, and this will be, of course, g of zero. And so when you read this, you see that the function g defined in this way has a minimum value at zero. because for every epsilon, it is larger than G0. Then it is, one can use the standard methods of calculus. The function G has a minimum value 0. This means that necessarily the derivative must be equal to 0. But what is this derivative? This derivative can be computed because we have to compute the derivative of this. The functional is written in this form. And so you have to imagine that now I write this expression plus epsilon phi prime, and I can take the derivative under the integral sign. And so very quickly I arrive to this expression ux u prime x times phi of x plus f xi x u prime x phi prime. And so everything here, this is, we know that it must be equal to 0. So now the next step is to integrate by parts. So I want to put this derivative on this term. And since the function phi is 0 at the boundary, there is no finite term when I consider the integration by parts. So this integral here can be written in this form that is more convenient. So is fy xu u prime minus the derivative with respect to x of this term, and then everything is multiplied by phi, because I moved the derivative, so here what remains is phi, and this is as I said before, is equal to 0. But remember that this is true for every phi which satisfies this condition. And so now the fact that the integral vanishes for every choice of phi implies that the term in the curly bracket is 0. And this is good news, because this is an equality between these two terms that I write here, d over dx of f xi computed in x u and u prime is equal to f y x u prime. And this is now an equality that must be satisfied for every point in our interval. And so this argument shows that if u is a minimizer, because we started from the idea that u, then u must satisfy this differential equation. And so what one can do then is, since we are looking for minimizers, then the trick is, first, try to solve this differential equation. In some cases it will be very difficult, but in some cases it is easy. And then we are restricting the attention just to the solution of this differential equation. So it's like what you do in calculus when you want to minimize some function. You look at the points where the first derivative is 0. This is just a necessary condition. It's not sufficient in general, but then you have to consider just a finite number of points. And so also here, this equation rules out a lot of functions, and then you focus the attention just on the solutions of this, and then you try to prove that what you found as a solution of this equation is actually a minimizer. So just some words about the structure of this equation. So this equation, in general, is nonlinear. So it is linear when this derivative with respect to xi is linear in xi, which means that we start from a functional which is quadratic with respect to xi. But except that case, this is nonlinear. But if you develop this derivative, you get the second derivative with respect to xi, u prime times u second, and then plus lower order terms. So I mean terms which do not contain the second derivatives. So this is equal to zero. And so you see that the structure of this equation will be that it is linear in the first, in the derivative of highest order, but non-linear with respect to the rest. So it is a quasi-linear equation. Also, this formula here shows that if this second derivative with respect to xi is different from zero, which is something that happens in many interesting examples. For instance, it happens in this example. Then one can write this equation in a better way because one can isolate u second and the equation is written in normal form, and then one can apply all machinery of ordinary differential equations to solve this kind of problem. Now, the same, the very same argument will say that if we start with the case, the same problem in dimension n, then we end up with a partial differential equation. N is the dimension of the space, which has this form. You see that it's very similar to the previous one, but there is just some small change due to the fact that now we have n components of the vector xi. So we have this expression is equal to fy x u gradient u, and this must be satisfied for every x in omega. So in this case, our problem, so the minimality leads to a partial differential equation in omega, and so this is, in general, a more difficult problem than this, because, yeah, in a sense, there are a lot of methods to solve ordinary differential equations, while for partial differential equations, the problem is, in some cases, much harder. And so, in some sense, what happens, at least this is what happened historically, is that if you want to solve a minimum problem in the case of a problem in dimension one, the best you can do is try to solve the ordinary differential equation, because there is a well-developed theory and there are also in many cases a lot of tricks to find explicitly the solution. Then try to show that this solution is a minimizer. On the contrary, in the case of the partial differential equation, you can act conversely. So maybe you have some method to find directly that there is a minimizer, and then this method will provide you with a solution of the partial differential equation. So now, just to have a quick idea of what you get from this method in the one-dimensional case, let us consider the special case of the area of surfaces of rotation. So in the case, this equation, I've not mentioned it, is called the Euler equation, or sometimes the Euler-Lagrange equation. And also its extension to dimension n is called the Euler-Lagrange equation of the problem. Then if you have that u is vector-valued, then this becomes a system. But let us stay with the easier case where u is a scalar. So, for instance, in this case of the surfaces of revolution, the solutions of the Euler equation are explicit. So the solutions of the Euler-Lagrange equation are not only explicit, but also very easy to remember, are of the form u of x equal a hyperbolic cosine x minus b divided by a. So, more or less, they have all the same shape, and they depend, so the shape is the one of a catenary, so this hyperbolic cosine of x. Then instead of x, you have to shift it a little bit, and with this a, you play with the amplitude of this. So you have to expect that it depends on two parameters because it will be a solution of a second order differential equation that, as I told you, can be written in normal form. So this is exactly what you expect. Now, then, to make a long story short, I can explain what is the solution in the case of this kind of functional? Because it is clear that there will be some problems. So suppose that we have fixed here A and B, and suppose that for simplicity A is fixed at 0 and the alpha is fixed at 1, so we fix just to normalize. Then what happens? Then you have your point B beta, and you would like to find a solution of the Euler equation, which is written like this, that passes through these two points. Yeah, but now, if you try to do this, you discover that this is not always possible. This is possible only if the point B beta is above some curve that I call G of X. So there is a well-defined curve with the property that if this point is above, then we have not only one, but even two solutions of this. One is like in this picture, and the second one is a tangent to this curve at some point. If you are exactly in this curve, there is only one solution. So there is only one solution of the Euler equation that passes through these points. And if you are below, there is no solution. So this maybe is the first surprise, because if you say no solution, this means that there will be no solution of the minimum problem. And indeed, this is what happens really, because you have to think that when the problem, when I formulated the problem in this way, I assumed that the function u is strictly positive everywhere. But the point is that it might happen that with a function that is strictly positive everywhere, you can approximate this curve here in this way. So this will be my approximating functions. And the limit is not the graph of a function. It is, anyway, a curve, a U-shaped curve. And then what happens? If you rotate this, what you get in the limiting case are two disks connected by a segment. This is the point. And so, but this is not something that you can write in this form, unless you give a generalized meaning to what is written here, because you cannot compute the area when this is vertical using that formula. And so, in some sense, in that formulation, you neglect this, which is limit of functions that can be written in this way. So, one can suspect that when the point that you have to reach is in this region, then the best you can do is to approximate this curve. And in this case, you see that if you want to approximate it by functions like this, you never reach the value that you get in the limit. And this is precisely what happens. So here you have that the infimum of the area is well defined, and it will be given by the area of the two disks. This infimum is not attained by a particular function, a smooth function defined in the domain. And so the point is that we have to admit that there is no solution of the problem of minimizing this expression among regular functions which take the value alpha 1 at 0 and the beta in the other point. So even in this elementary case, you have examples of non-existence. Now what happens if you are above? Then you have two possible solutions of the Euler equation, and then a more refined argument rules out the one that is a tangent, so the smaller one, and you can prove that the larger one is always a local minimizer. So if you perturb this slightly, you can only increase the value of the area, but you have that it is not always the global minimizer. You have to compare the value. You have to take the solution U, which passes through these two points. You take the largest of the two, the larger of the two, and then you have to compare the value of the functional on this solution with what you can obtain by this construction. And what you can obtain with this construction is clearly 1/2 pi, no, is just pi, because pi times 1 plus pi multiplied by beta squared. So you have to now compare this with this. If it happens that the inequality is the one that I have written, so that the area of the two disks is less than the area generated by the catenary, then it is more convenient to approximate this function rather than to take this solution. And so this is a case where you don't have solution. And on the contrary, if you have this inequality, then the solution is given by this catenary. And so one can make this analysis more precise, and one divides there is a second function that I call H with these properties. If you are here above the second function, then you consider the only catenary that joins these two points and which does not touch the line y equal gx, and this will be the minimizer. If you are here, there will be no minimizer, and the best you can do is to approximate this, and if you are even below, you have no minimizer. So you see that in some sense the Euler equation is just the starting point of the analysis, and then even in this elementary one-dimensional problem, one has two other comparisons. So it more or less is similar, but of course more difficult than the case when you have to find the minimum of a function of one real variable. So you're looking for the points where the derivative vanishes, but then there is no guarantee that each one of these points will be a minimizer. And then you have either to consider second order conditions or to do other argument compare these points one with the other one. Okay, so this was just to give an idea of what you can do if you first solve the equation and then using the fact that you have an explicit solution, you find the minimizer. I have to add a remark about the case of dimension n. So in the case of dimension n, if we consider this functional, and you do this computation, you see that this equation becomes simply the Laplace equation. So in the case of the Dirichlet integral, the Euler equation is exactly, because here when you compute this, this is the derivative with respect to I of u, and then you take another derivative with respect to I, so, and then you sum them. So you have the Laplace. And so what you get is that in that case, a minimum point satisfies the Laplace equation. In the case of the area of the graph, that also we considered, then you can write what you get. No, I don't write this explicitly, but from this, then you find the condition that on the surface the mean curvature must be equal to zero, which is a classical result, which says all area minimizing graphs satisfy this geometric condition. Well, now to come to a more recent approach to problems with calculus of variations, I have to mention what is called the direct method, which is the method that you use if you want to prove directly the existence of a minimizer. Because here what we do is something a little bit indirect. So we first look for sufficient condition of minimality, then we solve the corresponding equation, and then we try to prove that what we get is a minimizer. So this is an indirect approach. The advantage is that in many cases you have explicit solutions, and then not only you know that there exists a solution, but you also know more or less explicitly how it is done. And so if one wants to prove directly the existence of a minimizer, then this is called the direct. So historically, this Euler equation, of course, was introduced by Euler in the 18th century. But probably, I think something similar was even used at the end of the 17th century. And then Lagrange also used it some years later, while the direct method was introduced in the 20th century, more or less, in 1920 by Leonida Tonelli. And here the idea of the direct method are two, so the tools for the direct method are two notions. One is semi-continuity. So semi-continuity means the following, that if I have a sequence of functions that converge to some function u, then I want that f on the limit, so my function computed on the limit, is less than or equal to the liminf of the functional along the sequence. Of course, this notion depends on the topology that you choose in the function space. So when you speak of convergence, this will be convergence with respect to some topology that will be introduced in the space of functions where you want to minimize. Then the second condition for the direct method is a compactness condition. More precisely, compactness of the set of functions u for which f is bounded by some constant. So, to be precise, for every real number t and for every sequence uk such that f of uk is less than or equal to t, there exists a subsequence such that UKJ converges to some function U. And when I mean converge, I mean with respect to the same topology that was used here for the notion of semi-continuity. Now, so these are the two basic notions, and now the direct method is very simple. So what is what's difficult is to think that these are the important notions. Because now I can even prove it now that if you have these two properties, semi-continuity and compactness for every t, then f has a minimizer. And the proof is really easy because you, first of all, know that there exists a sequence of functions such that the limit of f along this sequence is the infimum of f, because this is a property of the infimum. So when you have, so if there is a minimum, then you can take this constantly equal to a minimum point. Otherwise, by the definition of infimum, you always have a sequence like this. This is called a minimizing sequence. Then, of course, when we prove the existence of a minimizer, we assume that the infimum is finite, because otherwise you have nothing to prove. So if the infimum is finite, you fix some t larger than the infimum, and then you apply this remark to the sequence, to the minimizing sequence. So since the limit is equal to t, which is less than equal to the infimum, which is less than t, we have that this will be less than or equal to t, at least for k large enough. Now you use compactness. And so you have a subsequence which converges in tau to some u. And finally, you use lower semi-continuity. And so you have that f of u is less than the liminf with respect to j of f ukj. But now this was a limit. And this limit was equal to the infimum. And so you have found a function u on which f is less than or equal to the infimum. This means that u is a minimum point. So this is a very easy argument. And now the difficulty comes when you want to apply it, because the problem is what is the best choice of the topology. Because you see that these two conditions in some sense are opposite. So in the sense that if you replace this topology by a stronger topology, then it is clear that it is easier to get lower semi-continuity. Because if something converges in the strong way, then it converges also in the weak way, so the inequality remains still valid. So in some sense, the stronger the topology, the easier it is to prove the lower semi-continuity. On the contrary, with compactness, you have that the weaker is the topology, the easier it is to have compactness, because you have more converging sequences. And so now, in order to apply this method to functions like this, we have to find a topology which satisfies both conditions. And I wanted to give an idea of this in the one-dimensional case, so the function that is on the left. This is a theorem proved by Tonelli. Suppose that this f satisfies a condition like this. So from below, it is controlled by the square of this. And then suppose that it is continuous. And with respect to this variable, it is convex. So these are the hypotheses. So continuity with respect to all variables, convexity with respect to xi, and a control from below. Then the point is, what about semi-continuity? Because the first idea that can come to our mind is, well, this depends on u and the first derivative, so the natural topology to choose is something that involves both. So for instance, the C1 topology, something like this, because this is, will be even continuous with respect to the C1 convergence, because we have convergence of U and convergence of the derivatives. Yeah, of course, this is true. But then you are in trouble with compactness, because if you have a sequence which satisfies this inequality, from this estimate, you get that the integral of uk prime square is bounded, because you can control this integral by the functional itself. So it will be bounded exactly by the constant t. And now, can I deduce from this compactness in C1? No, there is no way. You can have sequences where this is bounded, which have no convergent subsequences in C1. On the contrary, if you use Ascoli-Arzelà theorem and you play a little bit with Hölder inequality, you see that from this condition, you have compactness in the C0 topology. So the topology of the uniform convergence on continuous functions. And so the problem is, well, in order to have compactness, I should use the topology of uniform convergence and neglect the convergence of the derivatives. But if I do this, then the risk is that when I pass to the limit, the limit function has no derivatives, so I cannot write the functional. So there is some problem with this, and this was solved by Tonelli by considering this problem in the space of absolutely continuous functions on the interval AB. Because this is an exercise not so difficult, if you have a sequence of absolutely continuous functions which satisfy this estimate, and suppose that they converge uniformly, you can prove that the limit is still absolutely continuous and satisfies the same estimate. Because absolutely continuous functions have a derivative, not everywhere, but almost everywhere, but this is enough to give a definition of the functional. And so if you want to apply the direct method, so the idea of Tonelli was not only to introduce this argument, but then to say that the correct space where you are minimizing the functional should be the space of absolutely continuous functions. And the correct topology is the topology of uniform convergence. And then a hard part is to prove semi-continuity, which uses the fact that this is convex. And you have a semi-continuity with respect to some topology which is weaker than what you would like to have, because you don't have convergence of the derivatives. And so in order to control, in some sense, the derivatives, you have to use this convexity assumption. This is an important remark. And then the compactness is obtained just by using Ascoli-Arzelà theorem, because from this estimate you find immediately that the sequence is equicontinuous, and the boundary condition gives you also that it is equibounded, and so then you can obtain compactness. So this introduces typical feature of the direct method. So when you want to apply the direct method of the calculus of variations, unfortunately you cannot use spaces of smooth functions that were the functions that were used when you write the Euler equation and things like that, but you have to consider functions like this where the derivative is not defined everywhere but just almost everywhere. But this is not a big problem, because then you can write also for functions that are absolutely continuous the Euler equation, and then you can use some regularizing properties of the solution of the ordinary differential equations in order to prove that when you have a minimizer in this space, this is really a function of class C infinity which satisfies this equation. So the direct method gives you in some sense a weak solution, a solution in a very large space, but then using this, you can prove that it is actually more regular. So what you solved is the problem that was proposed at the beginning in the space of smooth functions. So this was done in the 20s of the last century, and then of course there was immediately the problem how to extend this to the case of dimension n, which was particularly important because, for instance, when you study the Dirichlet integral, then you solve the problem for harmonic functions. When you study the problem for the area of the graph, you solve some problem of minimal area. And so there was an attempt to extend the notion of absolutely continuous functions to functions defined over domains defined in R2, in R3. But the first attempt was very, very complex because they tried to give one-dimensional definitions along all different directions. So this, it was very, very complex to try to generalize this to higher dimension. But then it turns out that there is a quicker way, which is the one of the Sobolev spaces. So when you want to pass with the dimension n larger than or equal to 2, the best is to study the problem in the Sobolev spaces corresponding to the domain omega, and the Sobolev space is defined by taking a function in the Lebesgue space LP such that for every I from 1 to n there exist some functions in LP so that you can write the integration by parts formula. So integral of u di phi in dx is equal to minus integral vi phi in dx for every phi smooth with compact support in omega. So this is nowadays this is the standard definition of derivative in the sense of distributions. But at that time this was completely new. So the idea was, I consider only those functions for which there exists a function which satisfies this property, and then this function vi is by definition the weak derivative of u, and then you can write your functional also if u is just in the Sobolev space. And so what happened next? It was possible to prove some lower semi-continuity theorems in the case of dimension n and when the function is defined in a Sobolev space like this. And for instance, if you have this kind of hypothesis, the same theorem holds also in dimension n. So you need the convexity with respect to the variable that then is replaced by the gradient, and for instance, continuity, you can do something better, but just to have an idea, continuity with respect to the other variables. And so if you have these conditions and this inequality, you have semi-continuity considering as tau the weak topology corresponding to this Sobolev space, or if you want the strong topology in LP, which is more or less almost the same, and you also have a compactness. So in order to apply the direct method, what you have to do is to formulate the problem in a larger space, and in that space you are able to find the solution. Of course, there is then the issue of the regularity of the solution, but this also can be done because then one has a way to write also the Euler equation, even if the function is only in the Sobolev space, and it is possible to prove that under suitable conditions, all solutions of the Euler equation will be indeed smooth. So this is, of course, in the case of dimension n, this is a very long story, very very deep, but at the end it is possible to prove, there are a lot of steps, to prove that the minimizer that you find in this weak formulation, if the function f is, for instance, real analytic in all variables and satisfies these assumptions, and there are also other assumptions on the derivative that for the moment I don't write, then you have that the solution U is not only in this space, but it is also real analytic. So this is a result that in this form was obtained by De Giorgi more than 50 years ago. So this settles the problem. So you have the weak approach by direct method, but at the same time you can prove the regularity of the solution. So now I have still 5 minutes, so I see that the new facts will be very compressed, because what I told you was at the beginning, so the very beginning of the calculus of variations that was developed in the 18th century. Then this fact of the Sobolev spaces is the 20th century, regularity is the half of the 20th century, and now one of the problems that was studied more recently are the so-called free discontinuity problems. And here I think that I will just give an example and explain what are the new facts. So the problems we have considered so far deal with functions that are continuous, have a continuous derivative. If not, there is a generalization of it, which is the Sobolev space, which is more or less the same, because the functions in the Sobolev space cannot be very discontinuous. While in this case, you consider a problem where the unknown is discontinuous, and the functional depends also on the discontinuity set. So the idea is that you have a function defined on some set omega with values in R. Suppose that omega is in dimension 2 or 3, and the function is discontinuous along a set that I call JU, the set of jumps of U. And I think that since I'm lacking of time, the best is to give the prototype example that was introduced by Mumford and Shah. Is a function that is used in the problem of image segmentation when you want to detect the relevant contours in a picture. So the idea is this: you have, if you have a picture, so this means that you have a rectangle of pixels, and then you have, for every point, just suppose that the picture is black and white, to simplify the exposition, you have a gray level, so this means a function g of x that between, say, 0 and 1, that says whether it is white, black, or in between. And so the point is that, so this is the rough output of the camera. But you would like to recognize the objects that are in the picture. And so the idea is, so in real life, you will see several objects that are separated by some contours. And so the idea is that if you want to make a sketch of what is in the picture, the most relevant information is contained exactly in the contours. And so there should be a method to detect the contours starting from G. Now the naive approach would be, well, take just the points where G is discontinuous. Because so if here I'm seeing an object that covers another one, then of course here there will be a discontinuity in the black and white. And the point is that this is not stable because the image has a lot of noise in general, even if you don't see. And so you would introduce as contours points that are unrelated to it, that are just due to noise. So you need something that is robust with respect to noise. And so the idea proposed by Man-for-Sha was the following. Suppose that I want to replace my function g by a function that is called u, that is smooth in some set and discontinuous in some one-dimensional set that will be called ju. And they proposed to do this by minimizing a function that depends on three parameters. And now I write the function and then I make the comments. So there is a first term that is this, then a second term, which is, say, the length, so the, say, one-dimensional measure of ju, and then a third term, which is u minus g squared. So you see that, so now this is our functional, fu. Now, it depends on u, but not like the functions I presented before, because they depend in a crucial way on the discontinuity set, which is also unknown. And for instance, in this problem is exactly what you want to look for. What is the meaning of these terms? So this term here says that out of the discontinuity set, which is the set of the contours, the function u should be smooth. So in some sense, you want to present, when g does not oscillate very much, a smoother version of g. This says that you don't have to introduce too many of these contours, because otherwise the length will be too large. And if you try to minimize this, you will pay a big cost on this term. So what you want to do is to separate the different objects that appear in the picture, but without making a very fine subdivision, because otherwise, if you are allowed to make a very fine, so you just divide each pixel from the others, and then you have no problem to make this equal to zero, or almost equal to zero. And the last term is called a fidelity term. This is a term which forces you to reproduce G, so to be very close to G. And then, of course, from the point of view of image analysis, it is very important to have these three coefficients, and then they have to be tuned very carefully in order to obtain a good segmentation of the image that you consider. So this is the problem. And now, how was it attacked? The point is, you have to replace the Sobolev space by something else. Because you have to consider functions that have this object finite, but also they might jump. And so this requires a function space that contains also functions that are discontinuous along sets of codimension one. And so this is the function that was used for this is a variant of the space BV. So it is called SBV, is a set of functions of bounded variation, but with particular properties that now I cannot enter into many details. So this, in some sense, in the direct approach, replaces the Sobolev space. Then we have to prove a compactness result, which says that if I have a sequence of functions for which this is bounded, I have a subsequence which converts to an element of this space. This also was proved. And so in this way, it was possible to get a weak solution of this problem. And then also there is a regularity theory, which says that what you get as weak solution is more regular than a general function in this space. So in particular, this set J is a closed set, and also it has the property that it might happen even in dimension 2 that there is a point where there is a triple junction, but except for some singular set of a very small size, on the rest this set is smooth, and if G is analytic, it is even analytic. And so you have that this kind of problem where the unknown is the set of contours has a solution and a smooth one. And so I wanted to conclude that this is related also to some problem in fracture mechanics, because in the case of fracture mechanics, the functional that one considers is similar to this, in the sense that, well, there is some boundary, so there is no term like the fidelity term, but you minimize prescribing some boundary conditions. And this term here is replaced by the stored elastic energy, which is not given simply by this, because it's a little bit more complicated, because U is a vector valued, and so on. But still, it is a quadratic term. And there is a term like this, which measures the so in the fracture mechanics interpretation, this set of discontinuity points is interpreted as a fracture that is generated in the interior of the domain. Because U represents the displacement, and so if the displacement is discontinuous along this line, this means that along this line there is a crack. And so this represents the energy that you have to spend to produce a crack, that from the mechanical point of view should be proportional to the measure of the crack. And so using the techniques that were developed for Manforshaw, now we are also considering this different application of a function of the same kind to a different field, because you see, fracture mechanics is a part of mechanics, while this functional introduced by Manford and Shah was introduced for image analysis, so completely different application. So with this, I stop and thank you.
You have a
here there is a microphone.
Case where the conditions of the direct method are not satisfied, are there hopes to solve the Euler-Lagrange equations? Like, is there possible to solve the Euler-Lagrange equation?
It really depends on the problem, because if you are speaking of the case of dimension n, it is usually better to find a solution through the direct method, and then to use the direct method in order to prove the existence of a solution. But in the case of an ordinary differential equation, it is possible under some conditions to solve the equation even without the help of the direct methods. So this is, for instance, if you consider one of the most classical problems, so the problem of the Brachy-Stokron, the direct method cannot be applied so directly because there are some problems. I didn't say that the direct method works very well when this P is strictly larger than one, while if you write problems that are related to area, length, and so on, you have P equal one, so there are some troubles. And so this means that in some cases, you first solve the equation and then you prove the minimality. While in higher dimension, usually you do the opposite. You try to prove the minimality and then using that, prove the existence of a solution.
Is that in dimension one we have always a solution of the Euler-Lagrange equation?
No, this is not true in the sense, no, there are many difficulties in the sense that first of all, you can hope to always have a solution if you can write this in normal form, so you can divide by this. This is not so difficult because in many problems this is different from zero. But then the big problem is that you don't have to solve a Cauchy problem, but a two-point boundary value problem. In fact, even in the case of minimal area, that is fits in this, it is quite elementary, you have the explicit solution, you see that there are cases where you fix the two values and there is no solution of the Euler equation that satisfies the two conditions. This is the problem is that for ordinary differential equation, you have a very clear, easy theory for the Cauchy problem, but things become more difficult if you have the two-point boundary value problem, which is the one that we need here.
Thank you.
Any other comment or question? Yes.
In Riemannian geometry, I believe these methods are used to show that there the existence of geodesics between any two points.
Yeah.
Are there other applications of these methods in geometry in general, other than, say, existence of geodesics?
No, there are a lot of, for instance, when you study these problems of surfaces with prescribed curvature and so on, usually you reduce the problem to problems of minimization or at least finding critical points. So the geodesics is just the most classical one, and a lot of the theory of the calculus of variations in the 18th and 19th century was developed around the problem of geodesics. But for instance, a problem connected with the minimal surfaces. And then even more, because then you have also the problems where you have like a Wilmore problem when you study. So the problem, you don't have just the area of the surface, but some terms which depends on higher order derivatives. So there are a lot of other geometric applications. No, the beauty of the calculus of variation is that there are applications almost everywhere, because in some sense, it started from physics, because if you think what is, so historically the first problem that was treated by this method is the problem of the Brachy-Stokron that should be classified as a problem of mechanics of a single material point, essentially. No, there were in the ancient Greek time, the problems, isoperimetric problems, but this was solved by a different method, essentially. So one started from a mechanic. Then there are, of course, a lot of applications to geometry, so geodesics and things like that. And then there is the whole, so the Lagrangian dynamics, which also interprets as a critical points, all motion of a system of particles, and so on. But then, what is remarkable is that then there are applications even that can be unexpected, like this Bamford-Shah. They use this variational approach to image analysis. Of course, there are a lot of other applications to the case, to engineering, because no, of course this was the basics, but then there are also applications. So for instance, you can consider shape optimization problems. So you have a structure, you have to optimize it. So this is, it cannot be written in this language, but it's still a problem of the calculus of variations. So. Is David Mann the same? Yes. So he wanted to study also this kind of problems. But I think that for a while he moved and he did most of his activity on this because I remember that so this was just the first proposal. Then they proposed something else depending also on the curvature and so on, because then there are a lot of other related problems, because when you are you want to analyze an image, you don't have just to separate the different objects that you see, but also to say which object is in front, which object is in the back. And so there is another function that takes into account also this order, and also tries to reconstruct the hidden regions, which is also important from the point of view of perception, because when you do some tests, sometimes you are convinced that you see something that is not in the image, just because this is the continuation of what you see in the image. And they also proposed a possible variational approach, say that the lines you reconstruct should satisfy some conditions connected with the minimization of some power of the curvature, if I remember well.
Well, actually, since you had a geometric flavor in your question, I mean, don't, for example, another huge point where all this story would be critical for is, for example, Einstein general relativity. I mean, Einstein equation can be written as Euler-Lagrange equations of the Hilbert functional after a long work, but and then you can try to see whether you can construct solutions with these methods. I mean, just we are at ICTP, so we don't, we should not forget. Or the Poincaré conjecture, or the solution to the Poincaré conjecture.
Yeah,
actually.
Yeah, it was okay.
But there was another question here.
So in the free discontinuity problem, here, the set Ju is uncountable. Set Ju?
The set Ju is uncountable, yeah, because if you are in dimension 2, the set Ju is the set of discontinuity lines of the function, yes.
Okay. And so when you deduce the Euler-Lagrange equation for R, so you use that function phi. So is it any regular function that you substituted U by U plus epsilon phi? So that phi is any regular function.
In the classical approach, yes, this is true. Of course, if you want to extend that approach to this case, you should consider a phi with as its own jump. Yeah, this can be done, in fact. So, because in a sense, here you have so two Euler conditions, if you want. Because you can do the following kind of variation. Suppose that you have your solution, and suppose that this is Ju. Then the first thing that you can do is I consider a classical variation of the function, but just in the rest, out of Ju. So you take a phi with compact support which does not meet Ju, and then I perform the usual computation. And so in this case, when I have the Truman for Sha, what I get is that this was fixed. I develop, I computed the derivative, integrated by parts, and so on. So I have a minus alpha Laplacian of U plus U minus G. This will be equal to zero on omega minus Ju. So this is nothing new, because this is simply the method of the usual variations applied to the function that is the sum of this and this. So I told you that when you have this alone, you get the Laplacian. This will give rise to this one. And so what you get is an elliptic equation out of the jump set. Then there is a you have to deal with the jump set. And here it is not convenient to consider this kind of variations, but you use another form of variation in the sense that you perturb this set through a vector field. So you consider a one parameter family of diffeomorphisms. You perturb U and also this set. And then after some computation, you get that the condition will be that the tangential derivative... Ah, I forgot to say that with this will also say that the normal derivative is equal to zero on JU. But then you have a condition on the tangential derivatives, and you have that the tangential derivative on one side square minus the tangential derivative on the other side is equal to the mean, to the curvature in the two-dimensional case of the surface. And then this is used to regularize the solution, because then we have an elliptic equation on an unknown domain, but on the on the boundary of this domain, so on the discontinuity set, we have this condition which gives a connection between the derivatives of U and the geometric quantities related to JU. And then there is a way to do a sort of bootstrap to obtain that, so simultaneously, that J is more and more regular, and consequently also U is more and more regular, because the regularity of U depends on the regularity of the boundary. But they play together, and then in this way, you can prove that they are infinity and even real analytic. But of course, this you can do, but omitting points like triple points and so on. So there was an old conjecture done by Manfort Shah. They said that in the two-dimensional case, the set JU should be done by a network, in some sense, of smooth curves, that smooth means even analytic, that meet just at triple points and with a 120 degrees angle, and if they go to the boundaries, a 90 degree angle. And they also conjecture that this set of singular points is finite. Hmm? And this is the missing point. This was not yet completely proved, that the set of singular points is finite. We have some estimates on the Hausdorff dimension. We know that the Hausdorff dimension should be zero, and so on. But so there is still an open problem here, but for the rest, a lot is known, that really the arcs are very smooth, and so on. This is
And sir, what are the restrictions on the values of alpha, beta, and gamma? What are the restrictions on the values of alpha, beta?
This, from the mathematical point of view, the three constants must be strictly larger than zero. And you see quite immediately that if one of them is zero, the problem collapses. It's completely trivial. Either you don't have a solution or you have only stupid solutions that are... but from a mathematical point of view, as soon as all three are positive, you have a solution. Of course, there is no uniqueness of the solution because there is a very high non-convexity due to this term here. So uniqueness is not true. Existence is always true. And this have a precise interpretation in terms of what you want to obtain when you perform the segmentation using this method. Because then, I don't remember exactly, but you have to study, because when you consider segmentation, you have to decide if G is something like this, and then there will be a critical slope where you decide that it is better to consider a discontinuity. instead of a gradually increasing function. And this is related to the interplay between these three constants. And then also another problem is if you have a very thin object, can you see two contour lines that are close together, or does it disappear? So also this depends on the interplay between these three constants. But from the point of view of mathematical analysis, so existence of a solution, regularity, and so on, they are irrelevant, also because rescaling U, or rescaling the domain, you can make them equal to one. So if you look in the papers of analysis, calculus of variation about this, the coefficients are always one. But of course, in the applications, it is crucial to choose the good ones.
So let's thank Professor Dalmaso again for this beautiful afternoon, and we have a little refreshment outside. So if some